Hi guys, I'm in the workshop today and this is a follow on from the Di2 versus mechanical gears video that went out on GMBN. You've been leaving your comments and questions down below that video, so I'm going to try and answer as many of those as I possibly can. John Kirk starts off with, is the maintenance easy? A lot of people don't have any experience with electronic gears. Really, it's a case of normal maintenance with your chain and cassette, keeping those clean. The mechs you don't need to touch. I've never lubed or taken apart any mechs, to be honest, so Di2 is no different. Of course, it's really just a case of keeping that battery topped up, so that is maintenance, I suppose. As I said, that's really easy. You just plug in to the display, and that takes about an hour and a half to charge it up from fully flat. As I mentioned in the video as well, you really don't need to do that very often, probably once or twice a year. That should keep you going. Joel DH says, is it waterproof? What about creek crossings? I've got to say, I've not tried that out yet. However, Shimano, in their own video about Di2, show that exact thing. And they say that they are completely waterproof. So I think I'll believe Shimano on that one if they're showing us with that. Of course, they're designed for mountain bikes. So, you know, you must believe them, I think. Arok Noval, can it stand the abuse again in terms of waterproofing, mudproofing and crashproofing? I think we've addressed waterproof. Mudproof, yes, again, mechs are no different. They're gonna last. In fact, they're probably gonna shift better in mud because there's no resistance through the chain. That servo motor does all the work for you. Crash proofing, well, nothing is completely crash proof. I've broken shifters and mechs crashing. Rear mechs, I guess, are the most susceptible ones. Having said that, I don't think I've broken one in 5 years riding. I have broken one recently in transport. They are expensive, so that is one consideration if you're thinking about buying Di2, is how often do you break rear mechs? I know some people break them more than others, but nothing is completely crash-proof. This isn't a viewer submitted question, this is one I've thought about myself. What does Di2 stand for? Well, it's Digital Integrated Intelligence, if you wanted to know that. Jarek says, you mounted the battery under the seat post, but what about stealth routed dropper posts? Well, there are other places you can mount your batteries. I've had one in my underneath the stem cap before, so inside your steerer tube. Also, some bikes are designed for them, so down on the down tube, bottom of there, there's somewhere to put your battery. Also, you can mount it externally on a bottle cage holder. So it's easily done, and you can ride a full suspension bike, definitely with Di2. The Chaos Engine has a really interesting question, I think. It says, Neil, if you're working a 9-to-5 job with a good salary, in brackets, not London money, and managed a couple of weeknight rides and a biggie at the weekend and some epics during the better months, maybe in the time afforded to you after wife and kids. And let's say you're running an enduro bike, an XC bike and a pub bike. Would you buy Di2 with your own money? That's a tough question. I guess if you've got 3 or 4 bikes, throw in a lot of money at Di2, it's quite extravagant. I've said that, you know, this bike, my Exceed, is a 2x. I haven't ridden a 2x bike for years, to be honest. And now that I'm running the Di2 on this, I actually think this is a bike that I would run Di2 permanently on because I'm not as fit as I was at the moment. I've been coming back from injury. It's really muddy. It's actually really nice to have that small chain ring and to just have the one shifter and that really crisp shifting is very nice. Would I throw the money at it? Oh, it's a hard one to answer, but I would definitely consider it, especially if I've got Shimano on that bike already, like I said in the video. You can just get the gear set, so you're just buying the mechs, the shift and the battery. That isn't too expensive, especially if it's XT. So I'll say yes for that. I would stump up my money and buy Di2. But thanks for the question, it was a good one. Brandog says, are the lever and mech wired or wireless? Everything's wired on Di2, so yeah, you go from the shifter to the display, to a junction box, to the front mech, to the battery, to the rear mech. There aren't any wireless electronic mountain bike gears so far. SRAM do a road wireless group set, but they've not released anything electronic on the mountain bike side just yet. However, MTB Wheelie Nut has opened my eyes a little bit and showed me this thing called the X Shifter. It's a wireless shifter remote, and it basically, it sends a message to a motor that pulls a cable. So you can set this up on normal cable mechs. You just then have a wireless sensor from the bar to there. It says this one remote actually has 4 buttons, so it can run 1 by drivetrain, a dropper post, and presumably suspension lockout. I've seen that, I've actually looked at their Kickstarter page now, and it's quite an interesting concept, but I think it's It's nowhere near as neat as Di2, because if you've got, say, a dropper post and a front and rear mech, you've then got to put three of those units on your bike to pull those cables. So it's not a very nice solution, I don't think. It's quite interesting. I'd like to try it, especially with a one-by bike with a dropper post. If you've got one remote to do that, it's interesting. It's definitely not as sort of refined as Di2. So I can't say from experience, but from looking at the website, I wouldn't choose that over Di2. Gravity Slave NZ. Can you use the same setup for 11 and 12 speed? No, you can't. Shimano only run 11 speed at the moment. There are rumors about them bringing out 12 speed, but no, Di2 won't work on 12 speed at the moment, unless Shimano release one. How many gears, someone else has asked. Basically, you can run 1x, 2x, and 3x on the training rings on Shimano. Of course, it's only 11 speed on the back, and you can run synchro shift, so you can have one shifter running potentially 33 gears. Also, like I said already, we can run 1x. I've run it as 1x solution. It's actually really nice. RABC Nesbitt is not a big fan of Di2. He says, electrically powered bikes, now electronic gear changes. Isn't the whole beauty and attraction of cycling that it's analog and all about moving along under your own steam? I know manufacturers have to stay afloat and technology is always moving, but what next? Self-writing pens, self-walking boots? He says, this grinds my gears. I get you. I'm sure there's plenty of people that don't like the idea of electronic anything. Gears, of course, aren't going to propel you forward. You've still got to ride the bike. I actually don't think that everything's going to go electronic. I think in the future, we'll probably still have cable gears. Just like people buy single speed bikes now and really simple mountain bikes, you know, fat bikes. I don't think everyone is going to want electronic gear, so I wouldn't worry too much about losing your old cable gears. I think there's going to be choices for everyone. Jason, also not a big fan. He says, unnecessarily complex, which again, I sort of get, but actually cable gears are pretty complex. Have you ever tried to take apart a shifter? So actually in some regards, it's not as complex, but again, you don't have to buy Di2. There's options for everyone out there. Hans Power says he wants to learn more about synchro shift, which I did talk about in the video, and how well that works. I think that would be the main major improvement over mechanical shifting in terms of ease of use and shifting speed if you're using 2x drivetrain, that is. I think you're absolutely right. That is one of the biggest advantages for me for Di2, for cross-country bikes or any bike that you're going to run 2x on. The synchro shift is great. Fully customizable using that eTube app. So you can set it. And apparently a lot of the cross country racers set it so they're in their big ring almost all the time. So again, you can choose when that front mech shifts down to the smaller ring, and they basically keep that for emergencies, just for those steepest climbs. But it's all about just having that one shifter that does everything. Yeah, that is synchro shift in a nutshell, really. You have got the multiple different gear maps. You can set those yourself. There are default. The two default synchro shift maps on there already, but you can play with those to your heart's content, really. Also, will the front mech fit my bike? So the front mech is modular. So basically it just comes as the mech itself. You've then got three or four actually different mounting types. So you've got two clamps, high and a low clamp, and then you've got two different direct mount systems. One of those direct mounts I've got at the moment. So yes, you'll get it to fit your bike. This is a question I've put in there myself, actually. So I've said it's electric, but from a rider's point of view, how does it differ? Well, really, it's all about the stuff on the bars. So you've got the electronic buttons rather than the shifter, and they've actually got a really nice click to them. So where you might expect something electronic is just a push, they actually do have a nice throw and a really positive click, and you can go two clicks at a time on there. Then, of course, you can leave your thumb on that shifter for sequential shifting, where it'll go all the way up or all the way down, should you prefer that. More questions. This one comes from Carl, who says, who changes their derailleur cables 5 times a year? Maybe I'm out of touch because I do a reasonable amount of riding and only need to change them when they break. Otherwise, they work perfectly. I said in the video that I change my inner gear cables sort of 4 to 6 times a year, and I do. I've got to say that I don't like the feel of it when they start getting friction, and the changes get harder to push at the shifter, slower changes down the block. I guess I'm a racer. I've always wanted to have the best shifting possible. I can't remember the last time I used a gear cable until it broke, but there's a few comments from people saying that. So fair dues, if you use one, that's great. I would say you probably would find a bit of an improvement from changing the gear cable a bit more often, but completely up to you about that, that's fine. Christopher GRONSETH says, not everybody is a bike geek. Half of the riders in my group don't lube a chain or know how to set up a tubeless tire. These people are the ones that half-ass charge their lamps or completely forget. I've got friends like that, of course. I'm sure we all have. They won't have a clue on how to set it up and maintain it. 2 years from now, that 6 month charge will likely be more like 3 months and they will forget to charge it. Just imagine the bad image this will create. Right now, this isn't rugged enough for mountain bikes, or better said, for some mountain bike riders. I think your final point is hits the nail on the head. You've got to be one of those people who likes looking after their bikes to have, I think, any nice kit really, because stuff is gonna get worn out. I know, like you say, I've got friends that have, you know, not the best mechanical knowledge. They don't know how to look after their bikes. Then possibly some of this stuff isn't for them, but you can't say it isn't for everybody, I would say. You know, there's a lot of people who do really look after their bikes, and for them, charging their gears occasionally isn't gonna be a problem. But yeah, I think it's still a very good point you've put there, Christopher. Phil Jones says, typical mountain bike tech, absolute daylight robbery. It is expensive. You can buy a bike for the same price you're gonna spend on the Di2 XTR full group set, but you know, it's up to people how they spend the money. You can buy a set of wheels, carbon wheels, that's £3,500, same dollars. So it's the same with anything, with cars, you know, there's always gonna be something more expensive. So the options are there. If you want the really highest technology on your bike, you're gonna have to spend the money, but you don't have to. There's no one saying you have to have all the nicest kit on your bike. A question from Trail Work. He says, wow, a charge can last 6 months, crazy. What does happen when the battery dies? Are you stuck in that gear? Well, actually, it's gonna take you a long time, obviously, as I've said already. You'll get some warnings from the display that you're running out of battery, and actually your front mech will fail first, and then your rear mech after that. So you've still got some time to get it into an easy gear to get you home, basically. So yeah, it doesn't all finish in one go. Of course, unless you're running one by, then your rear mech is just gonna stop and then you're stuck. But hopefully you'll have seen the display. You're gonna have plenty of warning about that. So of course, we've talked about the pros and cons of Di2. Not everyone's gonna want it. Really like reading your comments saying that you like it, you don't like it, you know, why your reasons are for both those things. But leave us some more comments. What do you think's next in this very high tech technology that goes into these bikes? Electronic gears, are they gonna go wireless? Possibly. Is Shimano gonna go 12 speed? I think they probably are. But after that, what next on bikes? You know, are we gonna get electronic wireless braking? I know that happens in cars, so why not on bikes? I'd love to hear your comments, so leave them down below. I'll definitely read them. If you wanna see a couple more videos, well, click over there for the original video where I compare the two, Di2 versus mechanical, and over there for another Di2 video. Hit the subscribe button to subscribe to GMBN Tech for some more in-depth tech features, and give us a thumbs up if you like this one.